All right, now shalom, shalom. Salam ta tene stili. This is Wendim RasTafari, and I is reporting for the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society. This is Friday, August 12th, 2016. It's 7:03 a.m. Let's see. All right. This has to do with baptism. But all right. Let's see, we're gonna tell the story of I and I lives. But you know, we're not gonna go into full detail, but there's something that we've kind of received, and we're gonna put it forth, but we gotta begin from the beginning so that it kinda like so that ones could see that it's not something that we just kind of like forcing upon ourselves, but really it's something that just, it's been manifested, you know, by the will of the Most High. So it begins with Ethiopia. there's something about Ethiopia. What it is, it doesn't matter. There's something about Ethiopia. I mean, something that drew us to her. Now it's no surprise now that we've, you know, studied, learned and shown I ourselves approved, you know, like workmen need not be ashamed. Basically, you know, to give like it just like a biblical reference in a sense, it all comes down to the fact that Ethiopia was that woman that preserved you know, preserved a testimony of that which is true enough to initiate within I and I that is lost a way home. And that same woman is who brought forth that man-child, that Lidj Tafari, the child to whom we are, to the child who must be revered, who is to be revered, that man-child that is to be caught up to the throne of David, that is the throne of God, in Ethiopia, through Solomon and Makeda, Queen of Sheba. And behold, now this child, once caught up to the throne, he's to rule, you know, all nations with the rod of iron. And so we see the fulfillment of this in Kedamai Khazelasi, ruling all nations, you know, the League of Nations, and then ruling the United Nations. So basically that's kind of like what Ethiopia at first meant. So it was a connection to something that is necessary for some of us. And we go as far as to say that I and I is the soul, and we sought our body, and we were found. And so truth and grace kissed each other. And behold, weep not, the Lion of the Tribe of Judah, Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And so this is where it begins in Ethiopia. It began with I was listening to Wendim Yadon Ethiopian World Net videos. How we got to it, I have no idea. And we just, there's a connection. It's something about it. So as we learned just a little bit, just by listening to him, we started drawing or painting, you know, Ethiopian styled art, you know, but Rastafari incorporated in it. Why? I don't know. But later on, we did know, because we would learn about the apostasy and how the icons or the images had been replaced by false images of white, you know, characters, which were not since the beginning. And so that kind of all made sense. The reason we would paint and do art is so that we wouldn't waste time, because we noticed that there was something very important that Ethiopian World Net Videos was putting forth. I can't remember if we were taking it like seriously or what we were thinking, but for sure it caught our attention. So as a little bit of time passed by and we're painting while listening to Yadon over and over throughout that time, that process of time, and watching all kinds of videos, it got to the point where we kind of noticed that it seems as if, you know, Haile Selassie first, who I accept to be God for no other reason but because I refuse the God of the world, then I must kind of pay attention to the fact that it seems as if we are to read the Bible, we are to accept Jesus Christ. Now, I didn't like this idea, but But who cares what I like or don't like? You know, coming from death, I was done with, you know, with what I wanted. So if that's what God says, then that's what I must do. So, you know, we was at work. It was our lunch break. We went out to a Dollar Tree store, a 99-cent store. We bought a dollar Bible. We took it home. Well, we went back to work. Once we were home, we opened the first page because it's a very, you know, a very cheap Bible. The letter's really small, so basically chapter 2 is in the first page, and in the first page, behold, the second river that watered the garden is the same that compassed the whole land of Ethiopia. And so basically we opened up the Bible, and the first page said Ethiopia, and we knew of this other scripture that we'd never seen with our eyes, for we had never read a book, much less a Bible. So we go on to the book of Revelations, and we go to chapter 5, verse 5. And, you know, and Elder said, you know, weep not, behold, the line of the tribe of Judah, root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And so for I was like, that's it. Like, need I need more? No, I don't. I mean, from beginning to end, from end to beginning, how could this not be true? So from that moment on, I'm not saying that I was received in the spirit, but it was enough for me. You know, I believed. I needed no more evidence. But, you know, as time passed, it was study. And if I remember correctly, during the Fasica, during the Pesach, that I was, you know, reading, going over, studying the Gospel of St. John. And that's where, you know, I came as one. And I remember clearly in that we were reading how, you know, Yeshua said to Philip, how long have I been with you? And you know not who I am. You know, if you know me, you know the Father. And I go to the Father, and because you are with me, then we will be one in the Father. And so I'm receiving this whole I, and I told you these things before they came to pass, so that when they came to pass, you would believe. And so all this kind of like came together, and I just got it, right? So anyways, what does that have to do? It has to do with the fact that there's something in Ethiopia that even Moses saw. Now, I'm not saying the Ethiopians know they themselves. It doesn't matter. Like Moses, he learned something. He came out of Egypt, and he learned something that, whether the people there could see it or not, most likely could not, because they're natives. They take it for granted. That's what it is. But for us outside coming from this hell, it's like there's something there. And it just, grace and truth kiss each other. And so you kind of, something happens. It clicks. It connects. And that gives you the courage to go forward onto Egypt again without fearing what it is. But this time, a little bit different, because then we have something to share. We have half of the story that has never been told that we then seek to communicate, because we've received it so mercifully, through mercy and grace, and you know, we don't deserve it, but still we received it. So it's only natural to go forward and want to share with everyone because you know, what could we say? Such compassion, such love. Undeserved. So what else but to react in the spirit of Christ, in this loving spirit where you want everyone to take part in it, you know, whether they receive it or not, we, you know, that's not up to us. But then we learn that most people don't want to receive it because Egypt is quite comfortable. But nonetheless, what ends up happening is that we learn something that we can see in Ethiopia, and it just connects, and then we could go forward on like Moses, having been drawn out of water, which in a sense is baptism, drawn out of the River Nile. And then we go and draw out, you know, a people for John. And as a matter of fact, you know, this coincides like perfectly with the testimony of the Queen Makeda of Ethiopia, because she says something very interesting, which is necessary to kind of take in consideration. It says, let's see, this is 1 Kings chapter 10, let's see, verse 6, and she said to the king, it was a true report. Now remember Isaiah chapter 53, who hath believed our report? To whom hath the arm of the Lord been revealed or been shown? So basically it says, and she said to the king, it was a true report that I heard in mine own land, of thy acts and of thy wisdom. Howbeit, I believed not the words until I came and my eyes had seen it. And behold, the half was not told me. Thy wisdom and prosperity exceeded the fame which I heard. So basically, she's saying, like, listen, I heard some stuff about you concerning your acts and wisdom. I didn't believe. But now that I come to see for myself, not even half of it was told me. You know, it far exceeds everything I ever expected. And by this queen of the south, by this act, will this generation of vipers and serpents and snakes, poisonous, you know, reptiles, will be condemned and judged through it, because she came from a long, long ways. You know, people died. It was a long travel, money, all the presents she brought in search of the name of Yahweh, of the one true God. So us in this time having the ability to search his word, which is his glory, the things concealed, revealed to I and I, his seed from generation to generation, having, I myself don't have one, but most people do, just an iPhone, whatever kind of like highly tech, you know, those phones that have internet and all that kind of stuff, from the comfort of your own home, all you have to do is seek. But who desires a good thing but he that seeks? And I found no one that desired a good thing. No one sought. But this woman, the queen of the south, Queen Maket of Ethiopia, she came from the furthest regions, not the extremities of the borders at the horizon, but she came from heaven, from the highlands of Ethiopia, just in search of a good name, the name of the one true God, Yahweh Elohim. And so that's to show we could just check it out on our, whether laptops, computers, or you know, like smartphones, but we choose not to. So that's sad. So what are we trying to get to? From that time on, we knew that the Ethiopians were a living sacrifice, and that they themselves are kind of like Ham in a way, even though they're mixed with Shem. They're Ham in the sense that they serve Jah just faithfully. Well, not no more, but for a long time, they kind of just went with it. Whether just unconsciously, really, just servants. But we get the opportunity to serve him willingly. That's to say that the Ethiopians are children of Edomai Chel Selassie, according to the law, according to the world system's law. Now, I and I is according to the promise. So we do it by choice. And but nonetheless, they did remain faithful up until the point that His Majesty stepped down voluntarily. So that means that for thousands of years, they've been preserved for us, to be a living testimony for us, lest that we were to be extinguished, you know. And I never forget that since the beginning, we've done what we've had to have done. And what we have to do is to do whatever little we can. And that is to realize what we must do, whatever we can do. And so we, since that day on, we've, you know, the evidence shows clearly that we've done everything that we possibly could to sustain, keep, and safeguard the good name of Ethiopia, the culture, the history, our truth, and most of all, the biblical interpretation or translation into the revealed spirit of prophecy in this time, Haile Selassie first revealed to us in Christ Jesus, you know, resurrected, pure, clean, true, sinless, and resurrected in the hearts of I and I that receive it in the Holy Spirit. So basically what we're trying to say is that our minds have never astrayed from the fact that we owe it to our brothers and sisters to lay down our lives for them and love, if we so love them, as they have loved us, you know. So all this is leading us to this story that we're trying to tell, the which we're only giving like a rough, you know, just summary of. So basically, one other thing I have to mention is that His Majesty clearly showed us that an example that I received as an example, he sent people abroad, students abroad, to go learn in foreign institutions and then come back and bring that knowledge, because it was much needed in order for Ethiopia to be preserved a living testimony for us to see that which was back then, and so that we could translate it to now. It had to be, you know, somewhat, you know, first of all, like elevated to the heavens and far from the reach of the evils of the world and the curiosities of the temptation, which is, you know, covetousness, which surrounds Ethiopia, but protected with natural barriers, you know, although quarrels and fights and wars from within, but at least, you know, a foreign attack was not really a threat. So it was able to be preserved, but it was preserved in a state that is much like thousands of years ago. Some would say backward. And for that same reason, for us, that happened. So because for us that happened, then we must go forward, having been sent out to preserve truth, and then go forward and reveal truth, because they have not known, they have not heard, they have not seen, because it has been kept from them. No doubt they rebelled, but still it is our duty to give everyone an opportunity to know the truth, so that they can make a conscious decision as to what they decide to do with that truth. But until everyone gets the opportunity to hear out the revelation of the spirit of prophecy, and this time Rastafari in Christ, Jesus, our Black Lord and Savior Yeshua HaMashiach, until then judgment cannot come to pass. And judgment is not condemnation, but judgment is the individual choice of each person, whether they decide to hear Jaword and mix it with faith and accept that it is true and living and active today, and that this word is true and fulfilled from beginning to end, and from the beginning, that the promise made to our fathers has been kept. You know, this is what I am innocent of, or some would say guilty. I am innocent in accepting that his word is true today. So all this led to roughly around November 12, 2012, we uploaded a video to YouTube, and that video contained a letter, the same letter that I and I had written, I don't know, maybe a month, maybe a few weeks prior to uploading the video. But the letter was a proposal letter to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, and specifically keeping in mind the reality of the situation. You know, it was our way of seeking out to do something about caring for the orphans, caring for the widows, and caring for the stranger. Now, who are these? Well, the widow is the woman without a husband. So Ethiopia, even though they betrayed His Majesty, well, that still makes them a widow, that church, that woman. Now, the orphans are the children which have no father. And Ethiopia, the church, that woman, has children which have no father. And strangers, are they the same Ethiopians as we are strangers here? They are strangers there because they are not free to think for themselves, because they don't even have the ability to receive for themselves, because they've been kept and neglected the truth for themselves. That is to say that since 1974 onwards, to even mention the name Haile Selassie first was illegal, to have a picture was condemned. And so that part of truth is not known. So they, being natives in their land, are strangers because they're kept from the truth, which sets them free. And whom the Son has freed is freed indeed. And so, you know, just kind of like a proposal. Now, we always do things without asking permission, always in the spirit, but for some reason, this is something that we didn't actually go forward and just do. So we sent in a copy of the proposal letter to Wendim Yadun, and if he has the records, then he has that evidence on file. It wasn't even electronic. It was a handwritten letter, and we made copies of it, and we sent it forward. The letter wasn't necessarily our way to send that letter, or because we made it, or because it was something about us. It was a proposal. It was an example, like, okay, let's just come up with the letter to which the society agrees upon, and to send out to each and every, like, Ethiopian Orthodox Church that can communicate in English, so that they know what's up. Because I was under the impression that there must have been a remnant within the church that we could you know, kind of like reveal ourselves to them, and they could feed off of our encouragement and strength and support, and we could sustain a revolution and overthrow the corruption which is within the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. Now, that is what I thought at the beginning, but, you know, the reason I'm presenting this is because the revelation has extended to a far greater, you know, vision that is no doubt true and must be carried about. You know, regardless of what ones think, this is when ones make a decision. Do you actually care for your brothers and sisters, or do you just take advantage of the fact that you can claim some kind of relation with the Ethiopians? Are ye not as the children of the Ethiopians to me, saith Yahweh, O Israel? You know, or are we actually, like, motivated to do that which we are called to do, and to reign and rule? That is my right by birth. I will not deny myself. And that kingdom, which is His government, which is His will that is done in heaven, let it be done on earth. and I am on earth. And so it is my responsibility to do what is necessary to do to bring about that from being made manifest. And so the question arises once more, do you actually accept the Bible to be true today as it was yesterday, as it ever will be? And you are willing to, you know, to give up the self or die daily, carry your cross and follow him. That is what makes me want to follow Jesus Christ. That's what His Majesty said. And so, and I follow Jesus Christos. And we try, you know, the best that we can within our human efforts, where we are lacking the spirit, make up for it, to approximate ourselves as much as possible to the good example that has been set for him. Although we make mistakes and we do commit sins, even as we do that as Christians, we know deep in our hearts that there is the possibility of forgiveness from the Almighty to live in this life, in this peaceful life, this healthy life is what makes me want to follow Jesus Christ. And so that is what I do. So I and I lay down our lives since the beginning. This is what we do. Everything that we represent is Ethiopia. So now, going forward, to add to that, we sent the letter, right? And, you know, well, whatever had been is, and it doesn't have to ever be, but we're still, you know, we're still working on this. But now the revelation has been updated, and that's what we're kind of like presenting on. As a matter of fact, we just kind of making way here because we're gonna, you know, it's led to this, you know, LOJSocietyEspanol, a good thing. So now, let's see, we're trying to maybe just find the letter real quick. Here it is. This is the original letter. Let's see. It probably won't get that clear of a view, and we probably won't have time to read it. Well, I guess it's backside too. Anyways, thing is, we got some other stuff that we gotta like review. So that's that. And that idea kind of, you know, no support, no real, you know, like encouragement, no evidence to show that anyone really sees any interest in this. Well, so be it. Now, right around June 2016, I updated a PDF document in which we explained kind of what that letter was, to show the letter and to show LOJSociety order. These are my notes. My bad. Admittance. Okay. So, okay, where do we, let's see, June 2016, let's see, so basically I kind of forgot. All right, so that idea kind of just was just kind of like just there, and maybe it was around November 2015. Something happened that kind of revived that motivation. So I and Wendim Rasburuku Tafari is witness to this. I mean, he can witness about our testimony to the Ethiopian woman that we spoke to, but I as individuals didn't actually discuss this issue. But so we ended up going to Sacramento to the Queen of Sheba restaurant, and so, you know, and I just looking at things and all that. And this younger lady, turns out to be the niece of the owner. She expressed, I don't know, somehow, you know, and I just speak about the Bible and all that kind of stuff. So eventually we spoke about Ethiopia, and she showed some kind of passion towards it and some kind of like just, you know, worry, preoccupied with the fact that something was going on which she was not comfortable with. And so that kind of allowed us to, okay, you have passion for Ethiopia, then we have passion for your passion, because that's our calling. That's what we're here to do. So basically, we began talking, and it turns out that she was born in Ethiopia, but she was exiled, and growing up in the States, in the United States of America, you know, as she was older, going back to visit, she realized, unfortunately, she thought that there's a big disconnect. You know, she's going back to her homeland, and she don't understand why people don't care about history, why they don't know history, why they don't want to speak Amharic, why they only want to speak English, why they don't care about the country. Well, why they're even kind of like, to a certain extent, ashamed to be even associated with the country when really they're seeking out to be American. And so she was kind of like, she was really, really troubled by it. She didn't know what to think. And so I said, behold, don't cry. I mean, I said, weep not, you know, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. His Majesty and our Father, he already took care of this. You know, he prepared this way before. He set this up so that, you know, I not being outside. And since the Bible clearly shows that from the beginning, it would be corrupted from within, then we were from without, so that we can preserve truth being without, coming towards inside, you know, coming in, going inside. Because we are inside of him, you know, but being in the exterior, in the physical sense, then we are just strategically located in these areas so that it be impossible for the enemy to know that we have advanced to a position the which cannot be impeded or obstructed in our path. That's to say, you know, because it is, you know, it is sound strategy or tactic to you know, attack an enemy where his force is weakest. But it is surely, you know, like sound strategy to or something like that, to go on forward where such obstruction of movement is impossible. And so basically that's what the scattering seed is, you know, to preserve the truth that was to be corrupted from within, we being from without, are kept within. And so we are Ethiopia. We are the living memory, the testimony of that which is, has been, ever will be. And so as long as I and I live, I told the woman, I told her Ethiopia is at liberty, because we do everything we can to learn Amharic, to study Amharic, to study the Bible, to connect Ethiopia, to praise Ethiopia, to remember Ethiopia, and all the heroes that have sacrificed their lives. And you know, we keep the banner, the flag on high. We keep truth, you know, that's what we're called for. And I expressed to her the many, many details concerning this and how His Majesty is who He is, and that is what I and I is to do. So, you know, weep not. Everything's under control, basically. But I asked from her one thing. I said, okay, this is what you're gonna do. I know that there's a remnant, I said, within the Tewahedo church, well, within the Ethiopian Orthodox church, but they will not stand up and rebel because they don't have the support. And why would they? They would be excommunicated immediately. That's where I was coming from. So I told her, listen, there's a remnant. I need you to do this. Please do it. You know, just trust that the fact that you can't explain why I am who I am and how we know what we know and you've seen what you've seen is enough to give you the strength to want to do this, even if you don't understand it. So go and tell everyone, all Ethiopians, home and abroad, especially people within the church, tell them His Majesty, the ones that He hath sent, they are on their way. They are becoming of age. They are becoming mature. They are becoming learned to the point that they can take responsibility, inherit their inheritance, and then rule, because it is our right by birth. Now, I said, you know, and if you have to be, you know, whatever you have to do to say it, if you feel best to express the fact that, you know what, these people, these Rastafari, you know, they came to the restaurant, whether crazy or not, whether demon-possessed, I don't know, not. They asked me as a favor to go tell ones in the church that the ones that His Majesty had sent are coming to age and are, you know, they're being made manifest. And so it's only a matter of time. I said this so that hope would be elevated within those faithful members within the church to you know, to hang on and to know that the Nazarites, you know, these warriors are coming forward to support the revolution and the overthrow of HaShaitan within the church. Now, that's where I'm coming from. And this kind of like some months later, it kind of like made me want to like, you know, activate that or bring to life the whole proposal letter. So roughly around, you know, and I'm just summarizing. So, you know, forgive, we're trying to fit this into a 1 hour mark. That's right around when this thing turns off. So I think it was like the PDF document version of the letter and the explanation is dated to July, I think, 2006. No. It's dated to June 2016. But like I said, The events that sparked the revival of this proposal letter to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church actually were somewhere around November 2015. But it wasn't until June 2016 that we actually decided to make an official documentation of what we've been mentioning. So we've actually put that forth in another video. And now let's see. Okay. So just recently, this is August, June, July, July 2016, you know, not maybe, okay, I have something over here that'll give me a more precise date, maybe. Let's see. Probably around August 5th. Like around August 1st, 2nd, anyways. So, and there's a video. There's some brethren and sistren, you know, coming up from Jamaica, Ethiopian Orthodox Church members, but faithful Rastafari, except, you know, as far as the Christ and His Majesty, the Church cannot teach that. You cannot learn that unless, you know, one be sent through the Spirit, and then those sent can then teach those that are called to be taught. So we say this because they're in a video, they're looking at some of the artwork and stuff like that, so that's that. But it turns out that I and I end up you know, coming together once more, and it's in a celebration, for details to which don't really matter, let's just say an Earth Day of someone. And let's see. And we visit the family's home. Now, let's see. So, and these individuals, you know, these brothers and sisters have been baptized by Abuna Yesihak. As a matter of fact, I even made mention at one point in time that, you know what, Abuna Yesihak is a faithful man and stuff like that. His Majesty sent him, but he cannot do anything for us because he's limited to the church doctrine. I said, His Majesty kind of sent him because it was a sign, like, hint, you're missing something. It's Christ, but you can't get it through the church, because through the church, you will have to deny me. And that's not fair. Why deny the Father to receive the Son, or receive the Son and deny the Father? Because in Rastafari, it will come a day that you can receive the Holy Trinity. That is to say, the first power of the Trinity, which is the perfect expression of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in one name, one person. One manifestation in which we are in the Son, who is in Him, in whom we are one. You know, Shema Israel, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Achad. And that is true. Achadu Amlak, one God, that is Zainai. So now, you know, and as I said this, you know, one of Ainai's sister, and she's like, oh yeah, you know what, I was his personal secretary for 18, 19 years, something like that. Then I was like, oh, you know, I'm not saying he's a bad person or anything. You know, sister, and she overstood. She's all like, I understand. I accept what you say. So during the celebration, turns out, you know, let's start with this. Turns out that, you know, I'm introduced to this lady. And then they're saying that I'm looking for this lady. I'm like, I'm not looking for you. I know not who you are. Then they mention, you know, she's the owner of the Queen of Sheba restaurant in Sacramento. I'm still not looking for you. I was looking for the younger lady, the witch I spoke. I know not you. I've never spoken to you. How could I look for you? And I'm interested in speaking to her because of her passion towards Ethiopia. And I'm here to put it to the test. I want to know if that passion is true, because I is true. And I is going forward with the works. And so, you know, if there's passion, then we can work together. And so basically, but I ended up speaking with you know, the aunt, you know, and, you know, well, we communicated this, that, details to which don't really matter. All we spoke about is the Bible in Ethiopia and His Majesty, because that's all I care for, to be honest. So now, and then, you know, from thence, or maybe before or after, I don't remember, but then, you know, this other brethren, that is also Rastafari, Ethiopian Orthodox Church, you know, his position, I really don't know, because the church cannot teach the fullness, so there's still some kind of disconnect. But he was coming from, he was flown out from Jersey, I think, and You know, he just came saying, you got to be baptized. You got to be baptized. You got to be baptized. You know, people, Rastas want to take it like a just spiritual thing. But he was like, no, you got to be baptized in the flesh too, because then you receive the Holy Spirit and stuff like that. And I'm thinking like, well, I know that I am, which I am, but I'm also aware that I am tried, because we are all tried, unless I exalt myself. And, you know, who knoweth whether that would be the destruction or downfall of I and I, so I and I must be humbled. And so, you know, basically I heard him out. I hear everyone out. I don't reject anyone, because if I reject one, then I will be rejected, and I don't want that. So, and I'm not saying that would happen the first time, but who knows, you know, we don't deserve this, so why even mess around with it? I'll mess around with other things, you know, but you know what, this is the only thing that's worth having, the only thing I do have, ever have had, and ever will have, and I don't need anything else. So I take it seriously. So I'm listening to him, and he's saying, you got to be baptized, this and this, this and this. And he begins to kind of get an idea of that, okay, I'm not your typical individual, although it was mentioned to him, no, this one's a little bit different, you don't understand. But still, I heard him out, and I said to him, listen, this is how serious I take what you're saying. I'm looking around. I'm looking for water so that I could say to you, behold, there is water. What preventest thy from being baptized? And he was like, oh, that's what the Ethiopian eunuch said, exactly. I would not take a brother's, you know, like words for in vain. So anyways, I said, that's how I feel. You know, if there's water, I'd like to get baptized right now. It makes no difference. I'm not, if anything, things could get better. I can't lose, you know. And if all righteousness must be fulfilled, so be it. Anyways, so the conversation was baptism, baptism, baptism. And, you know, and I start talking about the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. Surprised many ones, you know, how do you know this? Because people within the church don't know this. Anyways, baptism was kind of like the theme. And I think that's enough concerning that. But on our way home, I and I is like, you know, driving. And Sister Emmanuel, she's on the passenger seat. And I'm thinking to myself, not because I was doing anything wrong, not because I was in any kind of threat or worried, but I'm driving, it's really late, you know. And so I'm thinking, like, what if I was to get pulled over? Not because of anything other than the fact that that's the way I think some weird things, but I'm thinking for a reason. So I'm thinking, if I were to get pulled over, you know, the first thing that I would say, once they asked me, like, where was I going or what was I doing, then I would say that, oh, you know, I and my sister, you know, it was a friend's birthday, and we kind of, like, went to go celebrate, you know, the day passed by, we kind of, like, you know, it's having a good time, reasoning with the family, and so, you know, it got late, so now we're going home. And I said, the cop, the policeman, the first thing that he would say is that, how is she your sister? That would have been suspicious to her, to him, or whoever would pull me over. So I'm thinking this, I'm meditating. The first thing he would notice is that, no, what do you mean your sister? That would be strange, because, you know, ones would judge according to the color of one's skin. And so I'm thinking, what would be the what would be the most simple, the simplified way that I could express to him or make him see, help him understand without a doubt and without having to think very much, that this is what it is, and it doesn't have to be what he's been told it is, or what he's been indoctrinated to think that it is. And so I'm thinking, like, what words could I say? How could I make him understand that this isn't a make-believe, that this isn't a church thing, that this isn't like a, oh, they're brothers in the faith, like if it was less or anything like that. How can I make them understand that I am in the flesh, that I am human, and she is human. And if we are brothers and sisters in spirit, we are also in flesh, because we abide in flesh. How can I make them understand that before the eyes of heaven, it's well sealed, but the heavens don't care to prove to him or to anyone else that that is true. But how can he receive it with simple words that he could receive? Like, no, it's not just like a church thing, because, you know, like, naturally after saying that we're brothers and sisters, and there's doubt, because no doubt, you know, there's going to be doubt. It's, you know, the next thing would be like, is, you know, how do I not say that it's in the faith? Because then people automatically cancel out the flesh as if we were not flesh. You can't separate one from the other. You know, we have the same father. We're born of a different mother, but still we're the same mother, and we're the same son, because we're one. How do you get this across? So then I started thinking, well, It's according to the law that they recognize lineage. That's to say, because a birth certificate says a certain thing, then that is law for them. Then, oh, the birth certificate says that this is your mother, this is your mother. But in reality, who knows if you never even knew your mother? Your mother could have died. Your mother could have never taken care of you. She could have disappeared the moment she had you. You don't know. But in the birth certificate, according to the law, that's your mom. How do you tell a policeman that this person that may have a different color skin or may not be, by law, your mother is your mother? How do you explain that? And it doesn't have to be a make pretend. Oh, you're just pretending because it's in make pretend. Because your birth certificate, according to the law that we recognize, says that she is not your mother. But how do you explain it to him, you know? So anyways, so I'm meditating this, and you know, I got plenty biblical evidence to sustain why this is very important to understand. So anyways, that's that. Now, a few days later, I have a dream, you know, and ones don't have to make this to be anything more than what it is. It's what it is. The dream, you know, it happens to reveal clarity to the matter. And I don't base faith on it, but it is true. So I can't deny myself. It just is what it is. And we actually took the time. We woke up. We remembered the dream completely. And then we fell asleep again. And when we woke up again, we kind of remembered, like, just the necessary parts. And we decided to write it before it was completely forgotten. So this is what let's see, we're gonna read it roughly. Let's see. So now, well, it's dated to August 5th, 2016. It was like around 10 in the morning. Then we slept again, and then we woke up like at 12. So we forgot details that really didn't matter. This is what was going on. So we're in like some kind of room, some kind of apartment, I don't know, hotel room, I don't know. I think there's many Rastafari, but there was one that stood out because there was a change in him. He had full dreadlocks, you know, he looked young and all that. But then when an Ethiopian Orthodox priest walked in, I looked at him again, and everyone was the same, but he looked old, like an old white Caucasian man, and with a bald head and kind of like hair, white hair, like on the side, straight white hair, kind of like, you know, in not in patches, but not full, but bald on top. Anyways, when I turn around and see him again, he's full dreaded. So like a Korah. Anyways, so next thing that happens is that the Ethiopian Orthodox priest kind of grabs him by the shirt or by the neck or something, and he raises his hand as if to strike him. But he's only threatening him. He's looking at him with this face, right? Like trying to put the fear of Jah in him. And you know, but he has no intention of smiting him. And that's actually funny, because now that I think about it, I've always seen, you know, like in the Egyptian, like hieroglyphs or whatever, when there's one smiting his brethren, I've always thought that that's kind of like Cain and Abel, like Cain, Egypt, kind of smiting Ethiopia and breaking off. But that doesn't have anything to do with it. I'm not saying that that's what it is. It's just like an opinion. It always kind of reminds me of that. Anyways, this person leaves, and then the Ethiopian Orthodox church priest, he says, like, he explains to Ainai, he's like, okay, the reason I was like that with that individual is because he wanted to charge 72 hours worth of labor, like if to sign his hour worksheet, his hourly timesheet. And he's all like, he wanted to charge so that he could get a check for 72 hours, to which he did not work, and that's not going to happen. So I was just, you know, not intimidating him, but he had to know that he's not going to mess around or fool around or make a joke out of this. So anyways, then I go up to him and I speak to him. Then I say, okay, this is what happened. I was at this party, right? Not party, this get together, you know, the celebration. It was all Ethiopians and Ethiopian Orthodox church members and Rastafari and all that. So I tell him, all right. So I get there, and they tell me that I need to get baptized, that it's important to get baptized, that I should get baptized. And I said, listen, do I need it? I don't feel that I do. And I'm talking within myself. But then I expressed to them that I would not deny myself in denying you. And so if all righteousness need be fulfilled, I have no problem with it. If it brings comfort to a brethren or a sister, I'll do it. You know, I'm not, you know, away with pride. die daily, pick up your cross, and follow him. I said, I have no problem with it. So I'm asking you, what do I have to do? What is it that I have to do to get baptized? And the Ethiopian Orthodox priest, he said to I, he said, where do you want to do it? Where do we do it? And I'm all like, you know, I'm thinking like, wait, like, where do we do it? And then I thought in my mind, in the dream, I'm thinking like the shower or something like that. But then I kind of like got my thoughts together and I'm all like, no, but that's not what I asked you. I asked you, like, what do I have to do? What are the requirements? Like, is there a process? Do I have to go to some classes? You know, that's what I asked, not to do it right now. And then he's like, certificate, you need a certificate. And I'm all like, a certificate? You know, what do you mean? Like, I have to buy a certificate? So the priest just said, you need a certificate. You need to get a certificate. Anyways, that's that. I woke up, so I wrote down the dream. Later on that same day, I'm doing a study on show thyself approved, you know, just kind of like get the feel for the Be'amarnia to kind of like see how it differs and all that kind of stuff, you know. And as I'm doing that, I'm all like, what's the definition of a certificate? So I get the dictionary and it just says like a confession, like an admittance. You admit to something. But then it also says like a certification, a document signed or sealed that you give a witness, a signed witness, a certification. Then I start thinking like, all right. So basically, the answer that I got wasn't the reason, wasn't what I needed to do to get baptized. It was the answer to the question I had not asked, which is the reason why I should get baptized. So what he answered wasn't what I needed to do. I've been doing that since I've been called. I've been witnessing since the beginning. That's not what he meant. The priest meant that this is what you're going to get because you're already baptized. You're already in spirit and in truth. You're going to get a certificate. You're going to have a paper according to the law that the system, that this world system recognizes, that officially documents you as a member. And I'm thinking that now I need to go back to the party or to the celebration. And something that I learned as I was hearing, because the conversation was just Ethiopian church business and this and that, corruption and this happened in that precinct and that synod or whatever. And then I'm all like, there is no remnant. I and I is the remnant, but we are not a remnant until we become a part of the mother of the body, which is then a body with a remnant. So I'm thinking that, and I start realizing, okay, I hadn't seen it properly. I have to be the body to be a remnant and work from within. So now, going forward to the certificate, then I started thinking, okay, certificate, witness for what? Witness that you, like a name change, called from the womb by name, go back into thy mother's womb. My mother's a harlot, no doubt, but that is why we are going back into her in the spirit, so that she's not impregnated in the flesh, but through the spirit. And so behold, she bare forth a son. I'm thinking certificate, name change, a name change that is recognized by this institution which belongs to my father, though which is corrupt, though which then I can take back, because then I am an official member of it. Name change, I get married to the woman, to the body. The body is of Christ. Christ is the head to the body, you know. And so I'm thinking all of this, and so it begins to make like perfect sense. And so basically what's being made manifest is that it's a takeover. It's being wise as serpents, harmless as doves. What landed upon Christ's body, upon the woman, the church, the dove, with nobody even feeling it. And the dove was the spirit that came into the womb, piercing the soul. You know, so the son goeth into the womb, the belly of the mother, in the spirit, you know, being impregnated by a spiritual seed, not by the flesh, because we've been called according to the promise. And now, the serpent, wise as serpents, what happened in the beginning, the subtle serpent hissed or whispered lies and false interpretations, misinterpretations into the ears or the senses, the reception, the receiving senses of the woman. What is the woman? The woman is the church. The church is the body. The body of who? The body of Christ. The body in which we are to form members of, so that then we are official members of that same body, and thus we have a say as to the going about and the works and all business within that same body. And so be wise as serpents, harmless as doves. And so then we reverse the curse. We go back into the mother's womb, and then we pierce and penetrate that soul which is corrupt, and then we cleanse or purify from within, in the sense that then we will in turn whisper truth into the other members and raise or resurrect a revolution, because then they would know that, hey, do you know that they're keeping this from you? You know, Psalm 72 verse 9 says, Ethiopia shall bow before him. That's not what they're reading. Why would they not read that? Are we not Ethiopians? Then what are they keeping from us? What else are they not saying? You know, this kind of like, just like the serpent in the garden, but this time it would be not deceitfully, but speaking lies until we get control of the whole situation. And so we institute that which is true. And this machinery, this like system is already in place. It's just badly maneuvered. It's conduced, or it's being driven by a drunk individual. We take that drunk body, or, you know, board of members, board of directors, we take them out of the way with the approval of all other church members, because it is right and exact. We reinstitute the true faith, and then we can utilize this already established system to navigate the world, to go about and do his will. And it is necessary. And so this is it begins with baptism. Now, once would say, well, what would you say? How real or how true is this to you? You know, and we just kind of like just skim through it without really going into detail. Now, so it would be like a lot of information that we would have to like just add to this to substantiate it biblically. As a matter of fact, as we're looking up the definition for certificate, it turns out that the Shabbat study, RasTafari Sabbath study for this time is it's number 44, which is Devarim. Devarim is the confirmation, it's the repetition of the law, it's the second time, it's the for sure, it's the in his image and to his likeness and in his image, it's, you know, one like the other, we are one, it's the reflection of self, it's this is his will, I won and I mean, this is not his will, that's why you got punished. And so it's a repetition one time he gave himself up for the sins of many, but the second time to those that wait for him shall he appear or manifest perfect or sinless to salvation of the soul, to health, you know. So it's the second time, the confirmation. And within it, you know, in the New Testament, it's Paul, his conversion. He had blood on his hands, but then he converted, and then he fought the good fight of faith, and then he followed Christ, and he was baptized. In the prophets section, it starts talking about, you know, the widow, the orphan, and the stranger. You neglected them. And I've had a son and he hath rebelled. You know, why should I strike you? You don't get it. You don't learn. You know, come, let us reason. And then it goes on to say, I will reinstitute your judges, and you will once again be the faithful city. You know, you'll be called Zion, I think, or something like that. So basically, it's a conversion, a revolution, and then a reinstitution of that which is true. The judges are to reflect the image and likeness of the Creator, of Jah Rastafari. And so that is what I and I is, you know. And so we must judge accordingly, not to condemn, but to give ones the opportunity to make an intelligent choice for themselves. So now, there's two cases to which are necessary to understand. Joseph, even though he was blessed and all that, he was nothing in the world because he's spiritual. So to the world, that means nothing. The way and the only way that Pharaoh was able to make something out of Joseph was to give him legitimacy. How do you give him legitimacy? Well, you give him a body. You give him a body on earth because this is a spiritual man. It doesn't matter how blessed he is. He's spiritual. He's not of this world. So we have to sign him in, document him, or certify him into this world. So Pharaoh, what does he do before he can put him into, you know, the highest position next to him? That is to say, Pharaoh is only above Joseph according to the throne. So what does Pharaoh do? He gives Pharaoh to, no, he gives Joseph to marry Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, priesthood, a legitimate priesthood recognized by the world system, the which cannot be otherwise replaced, because the priesthood is, you know, it's passed down from generation to generation, firstborn to firstborn. And so we're not in that system. So it was only through Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, that Joseph got legitimacy, and then he was recognized as someone in Egypt. Now, when Jacob went down into Egypt, what ends up happening is that Jacob realizes, who are these? Oh, these are my children, Ephraim and Manasseh. These are my children with Asenath. Then Jacob realizes that, oh, this is the promise that Jah gave to me. I'm going to rule all nations through these. Joseph, these are my children. They're counted for my lineage. Anything you have after this, they'll be yours, but these, as for these, they're mine. And so he blesses Manasseh, he blesses Ephraim with the firstborn blessing, although it belonged to Manasseh according to Joseph. But then Jacob knows, he's all like, I know what I'm doing. I know Manasseh was born first, but Ephraim is the firstborn, you know, according to Jalla. And so since then, Ephraim and Manasseh are counted for Joseph's children. Because, you know, probably according to the law, they're accounted to Jacob. Now, according to the law, they might be Joseph's, and according to the promise, they're Jacob's. And so we see the same thing play out in Christ. You know, Joseph is Jesus, Yeshua's father according to the law, to the paperwork, but it's not his son in the flesh. But he's the son of the Most High God, you know, according to the promise in spirit. And we see the same thing go on with Moses. Moses, he's coming out of Egypt. He left Pharaoh's house, so he becomes a nothing. He becomes a spiritual man. But he gets legitimacy in that he marries another daughter of a priest of Midian, Jethro, her daughter Zipporah. So then now he has a body on earth. He has a church with the congregation of the flocks of Jethro, the which he led to the Mount Horeb, where they went through the backside to Mount Horeb, and behold, the burning bush, you know. And then later on, he went to go free his spiritual brethren, the Israelites, and brought them to that same mount. But the church had been established. So now, just like Joseph had two children with Asenath, daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, then Moses has two sons with the daughter of the priest of Midian, Jethro, that's to say Zipporah. He has Gershom and Eliezer. So those then are given to Jethro for a lineage, and it's established a lineage through Moses' father-in-law and his father-in-law, because you notice how they're, you know, certain the Kenites, certain ones are recognized as children of the father-in-law of Moses. So that means that, you know, Moses is actually the father, which Moses granted seed to him so that he go do his business. But according to the law, they've been handed over to Jethro and stuff like that. So that's a little bit complicated. It needs more explanation, but you get the same, you have the same picture. So Zipporah becomes the body of Moses, and Zipporah becomes a church upon which is the burden of the child. You know, Exodus chapter 17, you know, when they're up in the mount extending her arms out to God, that's to say Moses, Hur from Judah and Aaron from the Levites are holding up his arms. But what you don't know is that sitting upon that rock is actually the body, which is his woman, which is Zipporah, which is the Ethiopian, which is the burden. And upon this, the throne is set, but the throne is not revealed because the English translation does not translate that from the Hebrew and from the Amharic, and even the Spanish says it. So Jehovah Nasi, upon this banner, upon this pole, upon this sign, will you be able to see the throne of God on earth. Only through Ethiopia you will connect the priesthood with the kingship. Only through Ethiopia, only through the woman that stretches forth her hands and either offers the son or receives the son or has the son in the lap. But that is the woman, the body of Moses. Moses is the soul that conducts the body of Zipporah, and then the spirit of the Most High God is what energizes, you know, and seals that power of the Trinity. We got to stop, because this is going to pause. Shalom.